Hello everyone, let's get started with the next session on underground cables. So the learning objectives of this particular session are, so initially we'll start with the various types of cables. So various types of cables was introduced in the last session. So we'll again continue with different types of cables, their features, how they are constructed, and how they are protected from certain environmental conditions. So all that we can discuss in this particular session. And at the last of this particular session, we will also derive some of the expressions for insulation resistance and also dielectric stress of cable. So these two derivations are important. So let's get started with this session. So as I've already mentioned, the need of underground cables, why are they usually preferred? So how do you say that they're very much important? Why are only overhead lines or overhead transmission lines are not sufficient? We also need underground cables. All that we had discussed in the previous session. So let's get started. Usually, UG cables like overhead transmission lines are preferred to deliver power. And if the intention is to deliver three-phase power, so it is necessary to have a three-core cable or three single-core cables that can be preferred. So usually, and if you are planning to transmit a voltage up to 66 kV, the necessity of construction or the usage of cable would be a multi-core construction cable are usually preferred for voltages up to 66 kV. The main reason behind this is it is cheap. They are economical if this particular construction is preferred for voltages above or up to 66 kV. And for voltages above 66 kV, single core cables are usually preferred. And why three-core cables are not preferred for voltages above 66 kV is they are cumbersome and they require more maintenance, regular intervention. So that is the reason for voltages above 66 kV, single core cables are usually preferred than multi-core cables. So based on this, the normally used cables for three-phase power is a belted cables up to 1000 volts, screen cables for voltages between 22 kV to 66 kV, and pressure cables for voltages above 66 kV. So let's see what are belted cables. This is how a belted cable look like. So you have a conductor shielding. As you know, the general construction of cable, you should have insulation, shielding, use of SAN tape or jute. You should also armoring, serving, all that is again incorporated over here, but the terminologies that are used are different because directly the used materials that are used in order to ensure armoring or serving and metallic sheet, all that, the materials, whatever that are used in order to ensure that are mentioned over here. And again, as already mentioned, these cables are usually preferred for voltages up to 11 kV, but in some cases you can also prefer for voltages up to 22 kV. And paper, the insulation that is used over here is, material that is used over here is impregnated paper. Normally this paper is used to insulate the cores from each other. If it is a multi-core, you should have insulation between the cores. A paper belt, a layer of impregnated paper tape is covered around the insulated cores to provide insulation. A fibrous SAN tape or jute kind of a material is used. Why is this used? Because impregnated paper is already used. Again, you have one more insulating materials like jute or SAN tape. This is used to fill the gap between the insulated cores. And because of this orientation, it gives a circular cross section to the cable. Because of this orientation, arranging the insulating materials in order to fill the gap between the insulated cores, it gives a circular cross section to the cable. So this is about belted cables. And again, you have one more in material, that is a metallic sheath is used. Usually a lead metallic sheath is usually preferred in order to protect the cable against corrosion or any, it is making the cable mechanically strong. So it also protects the cable from corrosion, and it also protects the cable from mechanical injuries. So it will enhance the mechanical strength of the cable. And where are these cables usually preferred? These cables are usually preferred for low and medium voltages, because the electrostatic stress formed due to these voltages are radial across the insulation. That is the main reason why we prefer this particular cable for low and medium voltages. The stress formed due to these voltages are radial across the insulation. Since it is radial across the insulation, you should be cautious, and you can say that you can prefer these type of cables for low and medium voltages. And why are they not preferred for voltages above 22 kV? Because the stress that is developed will be tangential, acting along the layers of insulation. It will be tangential, acting along the layers of insulation. As a result, these cables are not preferred for voltages above 22 kV, and they're only preferred for voltages that is for low and medium voltages. And one more thing that we need to give attention over here is insulation resistance of the paper is less along the layers. The tangential stress, what will happen, it sets up between the layers, and because of this nature, there are chances of localized hot spots. This will also sometimes results in failure of insulation. So in order to prevent this situation, screen cables are preferred, because you are the main insulation resistant impregnated paper is used as an insulator over here in this particular cable. The problem of using this impregnated paper is that it sets up a tangential stress. Because of this tangential stress across the layers, it creates a localized hotspot. Because of this, insulation might fail, and again leading to so many damages. In order to overcome this, you have one more protection that is called as screen cables can be preferred in order to overcome this particular problem. That we can call it as some of the drawback of, one of the major drawback of belted cables. We will move on to the next one. What led to the development of screen cables? The drawback of a belted cable, that is since the impregnated paper has less insulation resistance, in order to overcome that, screen cables are used. For voltages above 30, when you get a problem of insulation paper getting damaged, then you cross a certain amount of voltage within 22 kV. If you just operate it, you may not find a problem of that. So if it is above that, and if you are yet again planning to use impregnated paper as an insulation, thereby there arises a problem. As a result, screen cables are preferred in order to overcome that particular problem of belted cables. So for voltages up to 33 kV, screen cables are preferred. See, these cables are classified based on the operating voltages. Under exceptional cases, you can also use it for voltages above 66 kV. So let us see the different types of screen cables. The different types of screen cables are H-type cables and SL-type cables. We will see these, what is this H-type cable and what is SL-type cables briefly. So let's get started with H-type cable. So this is our H-type cable look like. So you can see the terminologies that we were using in the construction of cable. You have a conductor, core or a conductor. You have an insulating material. So they say it is paper insulation. So you can imagine the type of insulation. You have conducting belts over here. And you have metallic screen, lead sheet. That's nothing but a metallic sheet. Why do you use it? In order to protect the cable from mechanical injuries. You have armoring, again, to prevent some problems that arises. And again, serving, the last part. So again, as the diagram itself is telling that you have a paper insulation, the layers, cable layers are insulated with the help of impregnated papers. So again, metallic screen is made up of perforated aluminium foil. This aluminium foil is wrapped over the insulation of each core. Okay, metallic screen you have, and that is made up of perforated aluminium foil, which is again wrapped over the insulation of the core. So you should again lay the core in such a way that metallic screen should be in contact with one another. That should be the orientation of aligning or arrangement of cores, such that the mechanical metallic screen should be in contact with one another. So you have a fabric tape that is covered around the three cores. You can just see how many cores are here. There are three particular cores that you can, it's a multi-core cable. You have three cores over here and a fabric tape is wound around it. Here, a cable will not have any belt, but it will have a mechanical bedding, armoring and serving. Why are these cables, what are the major advantages of H-type cables? The possibility of null spaces in the dielectric will be eliminated as the metallic screen help in absolute impregnation of the cable. So whatever you have, the spaces that arises in the dielectric, because that would create a problem of conductivity. Okay, it would affect the dielectric nature and that would again help us in conduction. So this particular problem is eliminated because you have a metallic screen that is helping, in turn helping in absolute impregnation of the cable. So this is a advantage or what say it is a characteristic feature of a H-type cable when compared to the other type cables. So then why should a null space be eliminated? Null space will reduce the breakdown strength of the cable, causing damage to the insulation. Once you say that the dielectric strength is disturbed, obviously the insulating nature gets affected. Insulating nature get affected. As a result, null space has to be eliminated, and that was eliminated with the help of metallic screen. Let us see what is this SL type cable. You can just see here the core is again being wound by a cotton tape. Okay, that is a change that you can see. Some changes in its construction that is visible in this diagram. It's almost similar to H-type. But what is the change that one can foresee in this particular cable? The screen around each core, is covered by a lead metallic sheet. That is a change. The screen around each core is covered by a lead metallic sheet. Okay, there is no overall metallic sheet, but armoring and serving is provided. You don't have an overall metallic sheet over here like how it used to be in the previous type of cables, but yet you have armoring and serving because they have their own advantages of having armoring and serving in the cable, because it might provide mechanical strength, it would protect the cable from corrosion, so on and so forth. The main advantages of this particular cable is it does not have an overall metallic sheet. So that is making the cable more flexible. Bending of cable becomes easy. So if you have overall metallic sheet, it behaves like a solid conductor. So it is making the cable that flexible would be difficult. Rather, it would break, cable would break, because when you're not making it flexible, cable would break. So bending of cables becomes easy because due to the absence of overall metallic sheet. As I already mentioned, you have a reduced possibility of breakdown due to separate sheets. This is one of the advantage. The main disadvantage of this particular cable are metallic sheets are thinner. As a result, manufacturing of cable becomes difficult. You have a thin metallic sheet. They're very thin. That makes manufacturing of cable becomes difficult. Some constructional disadvantage. You can use these cables for voltages up to 66 kV. So let's see the next cable. Next cable is nothing but a pressure cable. as the name itself will tell, it should have the capacity to withstand greater voltages, greater operating voltages. So they can, so you can use these cables for voltages above 66 kV. So solid type cables are not usually preferred because, as I said, solid conductors have a tendency to break down. Okay. And break down the insulation due to the presence of null spaces. Standard are better, and you also, and they also say that you have to prefer pressure cables for voltages above 66 kV. So when you're using it above 66 kV, yeah, they have to be more flexible, and standard conductors would also help in withstanding greater voltages. Pressure cables eliminate void or null spaces by increasing the pressure of the compound. Okay, pressure cables have the capacity to eliminate void or null spaces by increasing the pressure of the compound. The two major types of pressure cables are, one is oil filled cable, the other one is gas pressure cables. Let's get started. We will just see what is an oil filled cable, how do they, what are their characteristics, and also what are the characteristics of gas pressure cables. So this is the diagram of oil filled cables. You have an oil channel inside the hollow space. You can just see that is over here. That's nothing but the oil channel. And again, like how we have the other parts, like other components like bedding, you have bedding here, you have the usage of lead sheet, you have serving, matte paper insulation, core or the conductor part. So these cables, as you see the diagram itself, you can tell that they have channels or ducts for oil circulation, the hollow space inside. This oil under pressure is continuously supplied to the channel through external reservoirs placed at a distance of 400 to 500 meters along the route of the cable. Okay, so you have this channel that is usually meant, and this channel is the oil under pressure over here through this channel supplied through external reservoirs, and they are placed at a distance of 400 to 500 meters along the route of the cable. Why are you providing a space oil for oil circulation? Because it will eliminate the null spaces that are formed between the layers. The problem of null spaces we had discussed in our previous, just two slides before. So when you are filling this null spaces with oil, so the problem of null spaces, what usually we get with null spaces, can be eliminated. So once these null spaces are eliminated, you can use these particular cables for higher voltages that usually ranges between 66 kV to 230 kV. So once, as I said, the null spaces are eliminated, cables can be preferred for voltages, for a greater voltages above 66 kV, or for voltages between 66 kV to 230 kV. Let's see the different types of oil filled cables. One is single core conductor channel, single core sheath channel, three core filler space. Oh, let's see the, this is how a oil filled cable look like. So what are exactly how it works? So oil gets expanded. When you fill the oil with that space, it gets expanded due to the increase in cable temperature. Extra oil gets collected in the reservoir, and when the temperature decreases normally during light load conditions, extra oil flows and settles down in the channel. This is how it works. Oil gets expanded initially because of the temperature, increase in cable temperature. Once oil gets expanded, it gets collected in the reservoir, and as and when the temperature decreases, and as temperature totally decreases, initially it was high, that was the reason for oil to get expanded. Once temperature gets decreased during light load condition, because temperature can increase only at higher load conditions, the load increases, temperature increases because the current will increase. When the temperature decreases because of less current and also during low load, light load conditions, extra oil flows through and settles down in the channel. The main disadvantage is that the channel is at the center of the cable and it is at full voltage with respect to the earth. There is therefore a very complex system of joints is needed. You need, because when it's at full voltage, you need to be more extra cautious, and the complex arrangement of joints are necessary. Is necessary. That is one of the major disadvantage of oil-filled cables. Next one is gas pressure cables. Voltage required to initiate ionization. Here also you have a null space. That null space over there was filled with oil. And here again, you have to initiate ionization. So therefore, you are exposing an ordinary cable to high pressure. When you do so, you can totally eliminate ionization. Okay. The increased pressure over here produces radial compression, which tends to close any null spaces. Over there, you are using oil in order to close null spaces. Here, over here, you are increasing the pressure inside, and you are trying to close the null spaces. Because only when you close the null spaces, you can make the cable operate at higher operating voltage. And this is how a gas pressure cable look like. So this is the constructional feature of a diagram of a gas pressure cable. And again, it's almost similar to a solid type cable. And inside it looks like it has a triangular shape because of the orientation of arrangement. And the thickness of the metallic sheath is almost similar to that of solid cable. So this triangular section, the orientation helps in reducing weight and also provides low thermal resistance. This metallic sheath acts as a pressure membrane, and it's protected by a metallic tape. The pressure cables are led in a gas tight steel pipe, and the gas that is filled in the pressure cable is nitrogen gas. So the gas pressure usually produces a radial compression, as mentioned already, and it will eliminate the null spaces that is usually formed between the layers of insulation. Because of this nature, since you are reducing the null spaces, obviously you can operate this cable for higher voltages because its current carrying capacity or ampacity will be high. As a result, they are suitable for higher voltages when compared to other ordinary cables. The main advantage of this particular cable is the maintenance cost is less, and since you are also using a nitrogen gas over here, it will help in extinguishing any flame, any fire that can be easily extinguished because of the usage of nitrogen gas inside the pressure cable. The only disadvantage of this particular cable is it is expensive. This particular cable is expensive when compared to the other type of cables. Next one is extra high tension cable, as the name itself tells. So if you have to use a cable where you are operating it at very high voltages, above 130 kV, obviously you should prefer high tension cables. Extra high tension cables or extra super voltage cables has to be used. So these extra high tension cables are usually preferred. And again, over here also, pressure is used to eliminate the null space. Okay, and they are also called as pressure cables because they are under pressure cables. So with this, we will be completing the various type of cables that are normally used in transmitting power. So let's get started with insulation resistance of a single core cable. We also know that how much is insulation resistance is important in deciding the cable efficacy. So let's see how to derive an expression for insulation resistance of a single core cable. Okay. Why is it important? Insulation of sufficient thickness is provided to conductors of the cables to avoid any leakage current. Because that leakage current would damage the complete cable, or it may damage the process or affect the process. As a result, insulation of the sufficient thickness is very, very important. That is a deciding factor in order to enhance the efficiency of the cable. All conductors require insulation. The path provided for leakage current is radial, as shown in the figure. So this is how we are supposed to consider. This is a radial in structure, so you have a small thickness dA is considered. You have radial, you have two core part, one as a radii of single core. It's a single core cable. You have a radii R1, radii R2, and the distance between the radius 1 to the outermost part is considered as A, and dA is the change in the thickness value. It's defined as resistance offered by the insulation to the leakage current. Insulation resistance is defined as resistance offered by the insulation to the leakage current. So let us consider a conductor of radius R1. Intersheath radius is considered as R2, because you know from the construction of cable, okay, you have an intersheath that is used, a protection to R1. And let us consider the length as L, and insulation resistivity, let us consider it as rho. And the unit of insulation resistivity is ohmmeter. The area of cross section is considered, since it is circle, you can consider the circumference 2 pi r along with its length, it is 2 pi rl. So you are considering a cylindrical section over here of radius a, and the thickness is considered as dA. The change is considered as dA. So insulation resistance of an annual cylinder is given by, you can consider it as resistivity into the thickness divided by 2 pi AL. RL over here is replaced by A, because that is the one that we are considering. So rho dA divided by 2 pi AL. If you're considering it as rho dr, denominator will be 2 pi RL. The nomenclature, as you are comfortable, can be used. So let us see, what is the insulation resistance of cable RI? So you have to integrate it between the two radii R1 and R2, divided by the whatever the distance that you are considering, the part that you are considering, it is resistivity into the distance dA divided by 2 pi AL. So you are taking the constant to the other side, that is rho divided by 2 pi L into ln A with respect to limits R1 and R2. On simplification, you will get it as rho divided by 2 pi L ln R2 by R1. It, since it is insulation resistance, the unit of that will be in ohms. So what can we infer from the above expression? Insulation resistance of the cable varies inversely with the length of the cable. Insulation resistance will vary inversely. It is inversely proportional to the length of the cable. So as a result, RI is nothing but rho divided by 2 pi ln R2 divided by R1 ohm meters per unit length. But let's move on to the next one, that is dielectric stress in a single core cable. Okay, dielectric stress in a single core cable. So over here, you are supposed to derive the expression for dielectric stress. You know how much stress is important. As when will the insulation break? When the stress in the conductor increases. So obviously, when the stress starts increasing, there will be insulation breakdown. That is the reason we should know what would be the expression for dielectric stress in a single core cable. That will help us to design a cable for a particular application. So insulation of sufficient thickness is provided to conductors of the cable. Why? To avoid any leakage current. As already mentioned, that is the importance of insulation resistance. And when you say that the insulation of the cable is subjected to electrostatic stress under normal operating condition, whenever you subject a cable to under the stress, you will also have insulation. That cable, if you subject it to some stress under normal operating condition, you will definitely have a stress. That stress can be termed as dielectric stress, which is nothing but the potential gradient at that particular point. Whenever you cross a particular operating voltage, operating potential, what will happen? Stress will be developed in the cable. That stress is nothing but dielectric stress. That would also, if it further increases, insulation will break down, will break, creating so many problems. If the dielectric stress is more than the dielectric strength of the material, insulation will break. Each insulator, assume that if you use a Hessian tape or an impregnated paper or a vulcanized Indian rubber, it will have certain dielectric strength. We have discussed that in the last session, 30 kilovolt per centimeter. What will happen when you increase this? When the stress increases, means what? You are crossing the dielectric strength of the material. You are crossing the capacity of the material, capability of the material. When that exceeds, insulation will break because the stress will be more than the dielectric strength, or in simple words, than the capacity of the insulating material. That will cause insulation breakdown. Assuming that the cable is in the form of a cylinder, its electric intensity at a distance A from the center row of the cable is shown in the figure. Let's get started in deriving the expression for dielectric stress. You will assume that the cable is in the form of a in a cylinder. Its electric intensity at a distance A from center O is shown in the figure. At a distance A from center O is shown in the figure. So using this electrical intensity, that expression that we have derived in our module 2, we're using that expression, electric potential expression that is used over here. So electric potential with respect to point with at a distance A is nothing but Q divided by 2 pi epsilon into 1 by A volt per meter, electric potential expression that we have explained in module 2. So over here, epsilon is nothing but epsilon naught and epsilon R. Electric intensity is equal to the potential gradient G. Since it is equal, intensity is equal to the potential gradient, we can conclude that Q divided by 2 pi, you can say that Ea is equal to G, that replacement you are making. Electric intensity is equal to the potential gradient G. What would be the potential difference? Now, V is nothing but potential gradient is G. Use potential gradient to know the potential. So potential gradient has V. So in order to know that, to calculate that potential difference, you require potential gradient. As a result, V is equal to radii integral of radii R1 R2 into potential gradient G with the distance that you have considered, that is dA. So G is nothing but Q divided by 2 pi epsilon ln R2 by R1. On substitution of Q from equations from the previous equations, whatever that I've used, that is 6.4 in equation 6.3, if you use it in 6.3, you will get it as 2 pi epsilon V divided by ln R2 by R1 into 1 by 2 pi epsilon into 1 by A. So when you use the value of epsilon, what will you get? Epsilon is nothing but epsilon naught epsilon R. So this will be the expression. So potential gradient expression now gets changed into V divided by A ln R2 by R1 volt per meter. Okay, we know that the potential gradient from the previous expression, we know that the potential gradient is inversely proportional to A, the distance A. So G will be maximum when A is minimum. So obviously, since it is inversely proportional, you can get a higher potential gradient when the value of A is minimum. That is, let us replace A by R1. G will be minimum when A is maximum. That is when A is equal to R2. So let us find the maximum and minimum values of potential gradients. So now you are replacing A by R1 initially. So G gets changed, V divided by A. Now we are replacing it by R1, ln R2 by R1 volt per meter. So maximum value of G you will get when the value of R1 is minimum. Similarly, when you will get a G minimum, V is equal to R2 ln R2 by R1 volt per meter. Minimum value of G you will get when the value of R2 is maximum, since it is inversely, they are inversely proportional. So from these two equations, we can infer that maximum stress will occur at the surface of the conductor. Minimum stress will occur at the surface of the inner sheet. That, in simple words, minimum stress occurs at inside the conductor. Maximum stress will occur at the outside the conductor. So your G is maximum, gradient is maximum when you are very much nearer to the surface of the conductor, and the stress will get reduced, okay, when you are moving farther of the conductor, farther side of the conductor, that is inner surface of the conductor. So that is the inference that we can draw using these two expressions. So for a particular value of V and overall size of the cable R2, radius of the conductor gives a minimum value for maximum stress, as already explained. So let's differentiate G max with respect to R1 and equate it to zero. So you are differentiating G max with respect to R1, because why with respect to R1? For G, you will have a maximum stress for a value of R1. So differentiate with respect to G potential gradient with respect to R1 and equate it to zero. What will you get the expression as? This will be the expression that you get. So what is the value of R2 that you can get on simplification? You will get it as 2.718 R1. So when you substitute this particular value in equation 7, you will get the value of R1 as voltage divided by G max. So what do you infer from this expression? So the value of radius obtained from equation 6.10 is the one which causes least dielectric stress on the conductor. Okay, so this is that inference that we can draw. So the final expression that you get is R1 is nothing but V divided by G max. And this value of radius that you have obtained from equation 6.10 is the one which causes least dielectric stress on the conductor. Okay, so with this derivation, we shall end this particular session. So to summarize what we discussed in this particular session is, we have discussed about the features of various types of cables, more specifically various types of pressure cables, its constructional feature, and how, where all, for what particular operating voltages this particular cable can be preferred. All that was discussed initially, and later we derived an expression for insulation resistance. How are different parameters of insulation resistance will help you to design a proper cable, and how is dielectric stress important, what would contribute for increase in dielectric stress in the conductor. All that was discussed in this particular session. Thank you.